Welcome to this presentation in which I will describe an approach for developing countries about how to detect insect species, how to model their distribution with a crowdsourcing approach, and about connected decision support. This talk was developed by me and by my supervisor, Professor Engelbert Niehaus. My name is Sir Krapp. Since April 2013, I'm a PhD student in the working group of mathematical modeling at the University of Koblenz-Landau. My PhD thesis deals about maps describing the temporal and spatial distribution of human diseases and the exposure to pesticides in developing countries. Since this year, I am also a research assistant at the University of Koblenz-Landau, responsible for the implementation of an online study course in the field of environmental science. If you are interested in participating in this online course, don't hesitate to contact me. This talk is structured in 5 parts. At the beginning, I will give a short introduction. In the next part, I will describe the approach of this talk deals about. At the end of the talk, the results are presented as well as a discussion and conclusion. In tropical and subtropical regions, we can find a high biodiversity in general. Especially the group of insects is the most diverse group of animals on the planet, including more than 1 million described species and representing more than half of all known living organisms. Thus, a local farmer is confronted very often with insects, e.g. butterflies and caterpillars, ants, termites, and other insects. Dependent on the behavior of the organism, an insect can be a pest in the agricultural process, like locusts, a vector for diseases, like the Anopheles mosquito for malaria, or as a beneficial, like the larva of some beetles. Pests and vectors can lead to economic damage, e.g. through the loss of agricultural yields caused by a pest or through high expenses for agents acting against the pests, e.g. pesticides. Besides often economic damage, pests and vectors can also lead to a human health damage. This might happen if a vector transmits a disease like Zika or malaria, or because of human contamination with agents fighting pests, but also harmful for humans, like a large proportion of synthetic pesticides. According to the mentioned impacts of some of the insect species, it would be a benefit for human beings if they would know which insect species are located in the near area and what are probable countermeasures. Countermeasures tailored to the personal characteristics of a user or the location he is living in would be a great benefit for people, especially living in developing countries. This talk deals about insect species detection and distribution modeling with a crowdsourcing approach in developing countries. Such an approach has to fulfill some requirements to be usable in developing countries. In developing countries, the most farmers have a low income. That means that such an approach has to be a low-cost approach, also affordable by poor people. In the described approach, farmers have to build insect traps in the optimal way with everyday use materials like empty yogurt caps, plastic bottles, or mosquito nets. In developing countries, the most farmers have a low knowledge about agroecological relationships and also a low risk literacy. Therefore, such an approach should be constructed in a way that the farmers are not overstrained. E.g., in the described approach, farmers have to determine the species type of an insect. In the described framework, farmers have tools helping them in the determination of insect species, and also usable by people with a low literacy and with low ecological knowledge. Also, the method must create data and decision support with a not too low quality of information to avoid wrong or suboptimal decisions with a disadvantageous effect for the farmers. And perhaps the most important point, the described method requires the active participation of farmers. Past research showed that participation gets along with a benefit for the participants. Therefore, the participation of the farmers must lead to a benefit for them. But what do we need for the described approach? We need a working IT infrastructure, e.g. with available mobile internet connection, or at least with a working cell phone net. Also, mobile devices are needed, and best with a high-resolution camera. We also need low-cost insect traps as well as species identification software or manual comparative identification help. We also need a spatial and temporal geodatabase as well as insect distribution models and warning and response models. In the slide, you can see an overview of the approach. In the center, there's a group of persons living in an area with a problem caused by an insect. Some of these persons participate in the mentioned framework, others don't participate. Participation means that the persons install traps on their fields and that they are willing to determine caught insects, to store the data and to deliver it to the database. Let's think about a farmer participating in the approach. He installs a self-built trap on his field. After a given time, he will catch an insect in the trap. But the farmer doesn't know if the insect is a pest or a vector. If a farmer has a smartphone with automated species recognition software, he can make a picture, e.g. of the wing of an insect, and must then hope that the insect can be determined with the software's database. If an insect was determined, a local database entry is stored on the smartphone, together with the geolocation received from the GPS sensor, as well as the species name of the insect and the point of the time of the detection. If the farmer hasn't a smartphone with a camera, or the species he wants to determine is not in the software's database, he needs a manual identification help, e.g. with pictures of the most common insects. Then he has to determine the species type according to pictures and descriptions. After the determination, he has manually to create a database entry, e.g. with an app called OpenDataKit. OpenDataKit is a tool for smartphones as well as for ordinary cell phones. Entries are stored on a local database on the cell phone and are delivered to the global database as far as the internet connection is available or via SMS. To find the actual geolocation with a cell phone, tools are available, which determine the actual location via basic triangulation of the client GSM device location. In the next step, the collected data is delivered to a central database, in which all observations made by the participants are stored. These observations can be visualized with points on a map for each observation. By aggregating these point observations, it is possible to create density or heat maps. Based on these maps, together with distribution models, it is possible to interpolate the species distribution, also in areas without concrete observations. In the next step, personal data, like available income, are used together with additional data, like resource maps, to feed a learning and adaptive decision support system. The decision support system generates decision support tailored to the individual situation of the user and is delivered back to the user despite if he is a participant or not. In the following slides, I will describe the parts of the system a little bit more detailed. First of all, traps are needed to catch the insects. As mentioned before, such traps must be constructed of low-cost material, available also in developing countries. There are different easy buildable traps available. The type of the trap is related to the insect which should be catched. E.g., for ground living insects, it is possible to build a so-called burble trap, built from materials available nearly everywhere, like an empty yogurt cap and sugar as lure. A trap for day-active mosquitoes can be built with an empty plastic bottle, duct tape, and yeast. Such traps are low cost, but are also used in professional science. Easy readable manuals, in which it is described how to build such traps, are also available. In the described framework, species determination can be performed by two ways. If a smartphone with a high-resolution camera is available, an automated species recognition software can be used. The genus of an insect is determined through the characteristic of the insect's wing. First, a picture of the wing has to be taken. A tool like the software Drawwing analyzes the connections of the veins of the wing, which is characteristic for each species. Thus, it is possible to determine the species. One disadvantage of this method is that the insect has to be killed and that a mobile device with a camera is necessary. Another method is to identify the insect with an identification key by hand, e.g. implemented in a software tool. The user has to answer questions about the morphology of the insect. After answering the last question, he gets information about the species. A camera is not necessary. A third method is the identification by picture books, which contain pictures of the most common insects. By comparing the pictures with the collected insects, the genus can be determined. After the determination of the species, a database record is created on the mobile device, either automated or entered by hand. The database records will be delivered to the central database as far as a connection is available. To generate species distribution maps and to generate decision support or early warning messages, a database is needed, able to process temporal and spatial data, like implemented in a GIS. To this database, the records originally stored at a mobile device of the citizens are delivered and saved. In the first step, maps can be generated, consisting of points, whereby each point represents the catch of a given insect. With each point, parameters are connected to, like the type of the species, the point of time of the catch, and the geolocation. By aggregating the observation at one point of time and location, it is possible to calculate the density of the insect species. The database can be connected to the GIS, whereby it is possible to implement models, e.g. to interpolate the insect distribution according to environmental parameters and to the species characteristics, e.g. According to their life cycle. Together with the maps describing the spatial distribution of the insects come maps describing the spatial and temporal quality of the generated data at each geolocation. These quality maps are important to determine the quality of the decision support and of early warnings. Based on the distribution of a given insect species and on individual parameters of the users, decision support should be generated. Therefore, a decision support system is needed and has to be implemented in the described system. The decision support system must have the following characteristics. It must be a learning system, learning from the feedback of the users. E.g., if a decision has led to a bad result, then the system should recognize this and implement the feedback for further decisions. The decision support must be tailored to the user, e.g. if the user lives in a region where mosquito nets are not available, Then the decision support system should not give the advice to buy mosquito nets, but an alternative method. The system should be also able to handle fuzzy data. E.g., quality maps are expressed in fuzzy values. Such a decision support system can be, for example, constructed with an artificial neural network connected with a fuzzy controller. But how can we motivate users to participate in the described approach? The participation goes along with additional expenses. Therefore, the participants must have a benefit through the participation. The participants have a benefit because data at their living area have a high spatial and temporal quality. Data at this location are data from reality and don't have uncertainties. Therefore, the decision support has also a much higher quality. The high quality of the decision support can lead to a health benefit and also to an economic benefit, e.g., if pesticides can be saved. The communication of these benefits is an important step to motivate people to participate in the described approach. And now to the results. I have demonstrated an approach which has different fields of application. First, it can be used for agricultural purposes to detect pests and to generate pest distribution maps for decision support in the field of pest management. On the other side, it can be also used to detect insects responsible for vector-borne diseases and to give decision support. The approach can be also used by citizens with, in general, low education and low agroecological knowledge. Through the use of the system, the users get basic knowledge in this topic, and this leads to capacity building and to informed decision makers. The system is made of low-cost methods and is therefore also usable in countries with low economic prospects, which are mostly located in areas with a high insect abundance. And perhaps the most important result, the usage of the described approach can lead to an economic and health benefit for people in developing countries. The approach described in this talk has some limitations, which have to be kept in mind when implementing such a system in reality. A working IT infrastructure is necessary, with at least temporary internet access or cell phone net. Especially in developing countries, a working IT infrastructure is not given everywhere. Also, the needed mobile devices, e.g. a smartphone with camera, is, despite its increasing use, not a standard in every part of the world. In the described approach, species are detected with automated species recognition software and with a manual comparative help. In common automated species recognition software tools, only a part of insects are implemented until now. New species have to be implemented in the software database, but also the manual species determination has some requirements. It needs a little bit of training to determine the species according to the images, and a minimum of literacy is needed to read instructions and to enter species observations in the local database at the mobile device. To generate appropriate decision support, additional data is necessary, e.g., maps describing the logistic distribution of resources. Especially in developing countries, such data is often not available or has to be generated. We can conclude that the described approach consists of different available subsystems. Mapping of vectors transmitting diseases can be, for example, performed with humanitarian OpenStreetMap. GeoRSS fields can be used to encode locations. A system to process fuzzy data and to handle with fuzzy logic is implemented in open source GIS like CrustGIS. But what we have to do is to generate a rule base in which the decision-making process is encoded. The rule base can then be implemented in a GIS. The adaptive and learning system has to be constructed according to the described requirements, e.g. as an artificial neural network with feedback and a connected fuzzy controller. Also, insect distribution models related to environmental parameters are not available for all insect set, and if available, they have to be implemented in a GIS. Thank you for your attention. If there are any questions, you can ask them in the following flash meeting, or you can also write me an email to rapp@uni-landau.de. Thank you.